Well, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. My name's Anne Barnhart. The reason why I'm here is actually a very bizarre story. I am unwittingly somewhat famous in certain circles, infamous in others. I don't know if you remember, but on Sunday, April 3rd, Lindsey Graham appeared on Meet the Press and said that basically he wanted to start enforcing Sharia law in this country. He wanted to keep people from criticizing the Quran and Islam, and the spur behind that was, I think the Terry Jones thing had just recently happened, and Graham, in the context of Jones, was saying that he wanted to be able to do something to push back against Americans and be able to punish outside of the law Americans who criticized Islam and did things like burn the Quran. I saw this, I actually read it, I didn't see it, I don't even have television, but I read the transcript of what he had said and was just livid, just absolutely livid. And this Lindsey Graham idiot, he's allegedly supposed to be a Republican. And here's this lawyer, this military lawyer who's also a Republican senator getting on television and saying, we need to start cutting back people's First Amendment rights to criticize Islam? Absolutely not. I was just infuriated. So that night I wrote up a script. I rebutted everything that he said sentence for sentence. And apparently I did it quite well because people on YouTube and on the internet really seemed to like it. And then what I did in the second part was I burned a Quran. But what I did was is I took my Quran and being the smart aleck that I am, I bookmarked it with strips of raw bacon, first of all. I had 17 Quranic citations that most people in this country have never read the Quran. They don't know what's in it. They're falling for this propaganda that it reads just like the Old Testament. It does not read just like the Old Testament. It's insane. It's the insane ramblings of a madman, and the concepts contained therein are satanic and evil to the core, and people out there have no idea what's in this book. So I went through, I just picked 17. I mean, there's thousands that I could have picked from, but I picked 17. I read them off, and then after I'd read it off, I tore the page out of the Quran, put it in a fire bowl, and conflagrated the thing. That's how I burned it. I didn't burn it in total. I burned it page by page, citation by citation. This is why we are burning this thing. And then what made it really forceful and powerful, and I think the reason why I'm famous, is the last thing I did at the end of my presentation was I gave my name, home address, and said, anybody who wants a piece of me, come and get it. Come and get it. I'm not doing this crap anymore. I am not bowing to Islam. It's either you or me. And if you want to come after me, you come after me. But you understand that if you mess with me, I'm more heavily armed than the French army, and I will kill you if you mess with me. That's what you need to be doing. We are cowering in fear, like the French. There's no excuse for this. We are Americans. You want a piece of us, you come and get it. You come and get it. And we will fight you, and we will defeat you, and it will be the end of you. Oh, you can't do that. You got to be nice. No. Nice will get you killed. Nice and $5 will get you a cup of coffee at Starbucks. Nice is over. Nice is over. And nice is not Christianity, ladies and gentlemen. Don't ever fall for that garbage. Nice is not what Christ commands. Nice means you don't know anything. It means you're ignorant. Literally, that's what the word means. Back in French to Latin, it means you know nothing. And you just agree with everything everybody says because you don't have any information of your own because you're an ignorant fool. Christ does not ever command anyone to be nice. He commands us to be not afraid. And unless we get our act together and we start acting like Christians and walk the Christian walk and be not afraid, exactly like the original 11 of the 12 original apostles who were executed. If those men had been nice, Christianity would have never gotten out of the upper room. It would have never gotten out of the upper room. They would have said, we can't do this. Well, we can't ruffle anybody's feathers. They walked out of that door and they went and they spread the gospel to the entire world and they died. They were killed doing it with joy in their hearts. That's what we have to do. If you're going to be a Christian, not nice. That's not Christianity. So, to our topic of Islam. There's a few, the main thrust of this presentation is sexuality inside of Islam, which again, people are completely ignorant about, and you've got to know. You've got to know. Okay? Yeah, go ahead. That's fine. Okay, so here we are. But there's a few concepts I want to cover first, because when you're out and people are speaking or you're at church and maybe your pastor's very wishy-washy about all of this stuff, you have to be able to rebut these things. And not only do you have to be able to rebut them, but you have to be willing to stand up and do it. Be not nice. Ruffle some feathers. Rattle some cages. Because if you just sit there silent, silence is complicity. You have to stand up and testify and witness. First of all, Islam is not a religion. We have got to stop this. It is not constitutionally protected. It is not a religion. Islam is a totalitarian, expansionist, militaristic, seditious political system. It is not a religion. The religious aspect of it is a fraud. It is a planned out fraud on Muhammad's part, and ultimately I attribute all of it to Satan, because Satan is the father of all lies. It was planned this way. It's a totalitarian political system masquerading as a religion. We have to call this, because if we don't call this out, they will defeat us with our own constitution. And that was the plan. Satan had this plan going all the way back. He knew. He knew that this republic would exist. He knew that our constitution would exist. He knew the First Amendment would exist. And he said, I'm going to destroy these people with their own rule book. So here is this totalitarian political system, and we're going to pretend it's a religion. It's a joke. It's not a religion. It's not the final, it's not associated with Judeo-Christianity. It is the ultimate bastardization and con on the Judeo-Christian milieu. Muhammad was out in the desert, and he said, okay, I want to start a fake religion so I can raise an army, get rich, raise an army, and so I can get laid. Okay? I'm dead serious. Those are the three objectives. Enrich Muhammad, rally an army for Muhammad, and get Muhammad laid. How do I do this? Well, I'm going to say, and again, this is the early 600s, he said to himself, I'm going to claim that God is talking to me and that I am the final perfected revelation of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm just going to jump on that bandwagon. I'm going to jump on those coattails, and that's how I'm going to do this. I'm going to sneak into it that way. And then, you know, all these people who are around me, think of where he is. He's in what is now present-day Saudi Arabia. It's weird to think that there weren't any Muslims in the Middle East at one point, but you have to understand, it started in the 600s, okay? So there were no Muslims there, of course. What is it? It's Jews, it's Christians, and it's Bedouin pagans. Okay, so he's jumping on this Judeo-Christian bandwagon, and he's also bringing in aspects of the Bedouin pagan theologies. Allah is the moon god of the Bedouin pagans. So he's taking all of these aspects of these things, bringing them in together and saying, oh, here I am. I'm the final perfected revelation of this. Join my army, fight for me, make me rich, and oh, yeah, I'm also going to have sex with your wives and your little boys and your little girls. That's it. It's that simple. And if you would read the Quran, you would see what an absolute joke it is. There's nothing theologically deep there. There is no hardcore Islamic scholarship, because there's nothing there. It is the rantings of a madman. He was nuts. You never hear Muslims talking about their relationship with Allah. Allah is never referred to as a father. There's no relationship the way that we have a relationship, of course, with our Savior Jesus Christ, or even the way the Jews had a relationship with God the Father. There's nothing like that there. It's shallow, it's stupid, it's ridiculous, and we'll get into that some more. So again, our three objectives of Islam: enrich Muhammad, rally an army, facilitate and legitimize his sexual perversions. And it did all three of those things. arguing that Islam is constitutionally protected as a religion is like arguing that Nazism is a constitutionally protected religion. And you say, well, no, it's apples and oranges. No, it really isn't. If there are any students of World War II and of the Third Reich, if you've watched any of, for example, the Leni Riefenstahl propaganda films, Hitler was totally trying to morph Nazism into a religion to fill that void. All totalitarians are trying to fill the religious void because all people in their hearts are called to worship. If you take away real religion from people, they're going to want to fill that void with something else. These totalitarian states, they realize that they can use that to their benefit. So think about the Third Reich. Think about those torchlight rallies, the torchlight rally at Nuremberg, where there's just thousands and thousands of them marching in formation by torchlight with banners. And there's a clip on YouTube that you can look up. Who is it? Is it Hess? I think it's Hess introducing Hitler and literally reciting a creed. We believe in Adolf Hitler as our savior. The Third Reich is God the Father, in essence. Hitler is God the Son, and the Nazi Party is the Holy Spirit. He was totally trying to drive into this. Think about the Soviet Union. Think about those parades they have. Huge parades of soldiers in formation, and then the tanks rolling down the street, and then there's Stalin or Khrushchev or whoever it is up on the dais waving at everybody. That's liturgy. They are trying to create a liturgy. Look at North Korea, same exact thing. They literally, those people are called to worship Kim Jong-il as God. This is not uncommon. This dynamic of trying to turn totalitarian political systems into religious dynamics, it's universal across the board. This is nothing new. And you could argue that the communists, the Marxists, the Nazis, et cetera, they got the playbook from Islam. Islam was first. Islam is the 600s, okay? This is constantly going on. So yeah, this is a very true statement. If you're arguing that Islam is constitutionally protected, that's like arguing that Nazism is constitutionally protected as a religion. Can you imagine? Can you imagine 1942 and having tribes of Nazis setting up meeting halls and us just letting them do it? Letting them organize, letting them set up basically de facto forts on our territory. And them saying, well, no, you can't do anything because we're a religion. We worship the Aryan God or something like that. And all of us in America sitting here going, oh, okay, that's fine. That is exactly what we are doing right now. Exactly. So you have to understand this, and you have to correct this in person or online. If you get on Lucy Ann or American Thinker or wherever you go, if you post, if you see people talking about Islam as a religion, you correct them. And it's getting better. People are now talking more and more and more about the fact that, hey, wait, this isn't a religion. But you've got to be out there, and we've got to be shaping this conversation and getting the truth out there. Because if we don't, we'll lose the propaganda war. All political cults co-opt liturgical rubrics in order to legitimize themselves and fulfill the human desire for worship. And as I said earlier, with our First Amendment, you've got a whole nother completely dangerous dynamic going there, where these people really are going to try to argue that they are protected by our government and our legal system. Can't let them do it. Islam is seditious against every nation and government on earth. Islam demands that all Muslims work to overthrow all nations, governments, and non-Sharia laws. Muslims should be thrown out of this country. They should be arrested and thrown out of this country because they are, by definition, engaging in sedition. Sharia law is sedition against the Constitution of the United States. They should all be deported. All of them. And the one moral qualm I have with that is the women and children. I mean, you know that they'd like to get out of it. What do you do? I don't know what the solution is, but we need to start talking about this and having this conversation. Again, reference World War II. Are you going to tolerate having Nazis, German Nazis, operating in the United States during World War II? Of course not. Why in the world would you tolerate this, much less facilitate it? I will also take it a step further. If the time comes when sanity is restored to this nation, these politicians who are facilitating this, who are facilitating the spread of Islam in this country, they need to be arrested. They need to be tried for treason and sedition, because that is what they are doing. It's treason. Yeah.